It's one apiece in this best of five. Jadon keeps his tournament life alive because if he had lost that map, being 0-2 down on match point for three games in a row, that's a lot of pressure. Now it's a level playing field once again.
And that's very, very important. Jadon, you know, he took a pretty hard loss in game number one. Game number two, though, he not only showed that he could win against Stardust, but he showed that he could hold one of his more classic styles. He could hold off the force fieldless composition. Still, though, we could see Stardust move back into that composition he went for in game number one as we do move forward. The next, map is going to be Star Station.
That's right, so we are going to be jumping into this next map pretty much immediately here. As you can see, we have a lot of people watching this. We've reached over 100,000 live viewers on stream, on Twitch TV as well. There's a lot of people watching on the internet. There's a lot of people watching on SVT1 right now as well. And there is a ton of people here watching live.
And it's quite an honor to have so many people tuning in. This series has been, I think, pretty promising so far as far as the excitement goes. The tension has been built up. A lot of aggressive openings, but solid holds by both of these players. And you know, as far as this next match goes, I feel like Star Station is going to be another map where it's quite difficult to acquire that third base for Stardust. Now, as far as what Jadon needs to do, he can still open up aggressively, he can still open up economically, but Apollo, what do you think will be the best decision for both of these players moving on to this next map?
Okay, Star Station. Let me talk about it in a minute, because we're about to load in. As soon as we introduce these two players, I will go into the nitty-gritty dirty stuff.
That will be quite interesting to hear, but yes, we are on Star Station and spawning in the top right position as the Red Zerg player just tied this series up 1-1, this best of five from Evil Geniuses. It is Jadon. Emotions are running high, Apollo, but you couldn't tell if you looked at Jadon's face in the crowd. You can tell in their faces. And this guy. Spawning in the bottom left position as the blue Protoss player from team My Insanity, it is Stardust.
All right, so it is tied one apiece. Jadon with one win, Stardust with one win. But what I want to talk about when it comes to this map, Star Station, a lot of Protoss players have a bit of a difficult time on it against Zerg players. And the reason for that is, on the third base location, when you attempt to take it as a Protoss player, it's very, very difficult to defend it, simply because it's out in the open. You need to cover a large range of area with force fields if you're gonna be able to hold this down. If we saw in the previous couple of maps, the locations around the map, whether it be aggressively or defensively, it's very easy to land force fields down and be able to hold the location. So if we have a look at the third base location here for Stardust, which is this base right here, look at the amount of open space around it. There's a massive flank from the left-hand side, there's a ramp straight in the middle, and even on the right-hand side. Force fields are not that big. They're kind of small, and you're gonna have to use a lot of them to defend it. And if that's the case, if Jadon goes for something aggressive, it is a little bit more difficult for Protoss players to defend. So what we often see on this map from Protoss players is an aggressive two-base push.
And it's very important, very interesting that you mention how many force fields you need to cover that area. We have seen Stardust go for many, many heavy sentry-based all-ins, and I feel like that could be key here because the ramp area, or at least the area leading into the natural expansion, the second base, is so much more narrow, it's much easier to abuse the positional play. But both players once again going for the very economic openers.
Oh, look at that.
And he's gonna actually take a second hatchery quite quickly, Jadon, basically trying to take advantage of the fact that he's anticipating his opponent going for this very heavy economic open.
Yeah, so what I just want to talk about here, Stardust in every single game. In StarCraft II, it's a strategy game, right? If you start to see patterns occur from your opponent, if he does X build time after time after time, there are builds that you can do to take an advantage over it. For example, in this game, and throughout all of Stardust, Zerg versus Protoss games, or should I say Protoss versus Zerg games, he opens up Nexus first for the majority of them. So in this case, there's no early rushes happening. There's no early attacks that Jadon needs to be worried about. So what he's decided to do in this game is say, well, if that's going to be the case, why don't I take a really early third base? If you can't do anything about it, why wouldn't I want to improve my economy and give myself a bit of a bigger surge when it comes to the 6, 7, 8 minute mark?
And a really cool thing about taking the fast third base as a Zerg on this map, if Stardust does go for that big sentry play, go for the big sentry stalker immortal push, force within the natural, it's pretty rough. But if he can force an engagement by the third base, he'll have to expend a lot more force fields to be able to get that positional advantage. So what Jadon wants to do is take a clear lead here. This probe for Stardust is going to be able to scout this, however. Plus one attack coming in pretty early, Apollo.
Look at this, though. I definitely feel here that we may see something aggressive from Stardust. I was a little bit distracted then. I got a bit of honey in my ear as I was pouring myself some honey and tea, and I was scratching my ear at the same time.
British soak in your tea.
Yeah, you know, we love our cups of tea, don't we? But looking into this game is that Stardust has spotted the third hatchery. He knows it's down. He needs to do something to kind of punish this, whether it be being greedy and teching up incredibly fast himself or being incredibly aggressive himself. I haven't seen any, you know, tech structures yet from Stardust. What is it? Okay, robotics facility coming down. So what I think that this may be is the build I described before.
And yeah, I feel like this is a pretty popular strategy, at least in Stardust books, something that he's really been employing quite significantly, going for the Immortals either for the forward pressure onto the Roaches or at least moving with a lot of sentries. And we do have those sentries already being produced. Stardust getting ready to get active on this map, already moving in with the Zella and the Stalker, pressuring this Queen. The Zella is quite low on hit points, though. What they really want is that Stalker, and they are going to be able to trap it here. A really big score if he can pick it off, barely getting away. Stardust, that Stalker, it's fearing for its life.
There's a couple of options for Stardust to choose from, and he has thrown down the Twilight Council and Forge. He's putting down that pylon to fake aggression, to prevent Jadong from powering his economy too much. This is actually a brilliant play from Stardust. A simple little maneuver has forced Jadong to build 12 Zerglings. He thinks his opponent's going for, as described, an early 7 to 8 minute two base push. He's even been denied scouting. Jadong's throwing down a spine crawler. His economy's been hindered because he's producing defensive units. In reality, Stardust isn't looking to push out for another good 5 minutes. He's actually powering up with double forges, upgrading twice. So he's going to be getting +2 attack and also +1 armor from both of these forges. He will also, from the robotics facility after this observer's been made, which is going to find out what Jadong's doing, start immortal production. And as I say that, we do have a third nexus coming down here. So it looks like I was trying to describe this kind of two base attack I thought was coming. But with this third base, he's going to take this third base. He will start immortal production. And around the 12 to 13 minute mark, he will go for a massive three base push. We've seen this play before.
Yeah, and the cool thing about how this works is, since he forced out the Zerglings so early, Jadon saying, okay, well, there's nothing here, so I'm going to go put some pressure on myself. He is going to go for a very interesting play, though, the Spire, but like, just finishing my point, by not having a crazy amount of economy, like you said, to get those Zerglings, if Stardust defense is basically quite fine, the sentries having to use their force fields, and he might actually be able to deny this third.
This is a big win here for Jadon, putting a spanner in the works if he's able to bring this down.
The Roach is going to be able to get right on top, killing the Stalker, killing the sentries, and the Tyrant is going to be shutting this Nexus down. The production is not yet fully set up for Stardust. He is getting the Immortals out, he is getting his +1/+1, but these three sentries and this Immortal are going to try to stop this, the ebb and flow of these Zerglings and Roaches, and the Immortal, quite strong, but he's going to barely save this.
Big play there by Stardust. Jadon can't be happy with that. That Nexus should have gone down there. He's trying to run by. Oh, perfect warp in there by Stardust. Oh, what? Maybe not.
He manages to slip by the Zealot. That means he can get inside the main base mineral line. A lot of that army is already outside the probes. Going to go for some hand-to-hand combat against them. He will be able to get the surround and take those out. But the +2 attack is going to complete. The +1 armor, something we haven't seen. 11 Mutalisks coming out from our Zerg player, Apollo. This is a bit different.
And also, if you look in the middle of the map here, I'll actually excuse that. He has scouted this. He's seen the Spire. The Observer's been chased away, so he doesn't know quite where Jadong's army is and what it's doing. We are going to see Stardust now approaching this 11-12 minute mark push out. He's coming for another attack. Jadong has decided to build Mutalisks. They're going to fly around. They're going to be a nuisance to deal with. He could counterattack with them. He could make sure he sets up a major defense at home. He has many options. But look, that army moving out, What is missing?
Well, it's
stalkers.
It's anti-air.
Yeah, exactly.
And the other thing is, these Mutalisks so good on this map. There's a lot of airspace around the natural, around the main base. Even that 30 can duck in from. But this push, he basically needs to do crippling amounts of damage while simultaneously holding off the aerial aggression. The sentries do have a bit of damage, but they're not quite as powerful versus these units. And there's nothing here to stop these Mutalisks in the natural.
All right, Jadon's going to go for this counterattack. He doesn't quite bring down that third Nexus. Once again, it does get saved. Mutalisks doing a lot of damage. Probes are going down. This is hurting the economy, but remember, there's a big attack up there. What Jadon's planning to do is hurt the economy so much that the aggressive stalkers can't be made. And down falls the third Nexus. And if Jadon can hinder the anti-air production and keep his Mutalisk count increasing, he'll be able to win this game. There just simply won't be enough anti-air.
Yeah, and you know, the other thing is he does have the Stalkers now trying to come in here, trying to make something happen. If he can defend this, he is doing a lot of damage to Jadon's bases, but Mutalisks, with the rapid regeneration of their health, they heal faster than any other Zerg unit, is going to be able to take these fights, and as long as he can slowly but surely kill the Stalkers that are being warped in, he's going to win this game. All the Stalkers are dead. The Mothership Core activates its last Fortune Overcharge to allow the Nexus to fight, but the Cybernetics Core, if he kills this, he won't be able to make any more anti-air at all.
Yeah, if he kills that Cybernetics Core, goodbye anti-air. That's gonna sting. He's only got two Stalkers and six Sentries. Sentries, he's got six of them, but they tickle Mutalisks. They rub their bellies. They don't do the damage necessary like Stalkers do. And all of a sudden, Stardust is in trouble. Despite Jadon being down in supply, he can't build any anti-air. There's a bunch of Spine Crawlers coming down. Look at the supplies. It shows that Stardust is winning, but he doesn't have anti-air. Only six Sentries versus 12 Mutalisks. He doesn't have any money. He doesn't have a Cybernetics Core. Jadon is mining so many minerals and building static defense to hold off that 1-1 base.
What Stardust is basically doing right now, he's saying, okay, my only chance at winning this game is if I can somehow kill off all of your buildings before you completely cripple me, or at least kill off all of mine. The Zerglings and the Mutalisks are going to shut down basically the last vestige hope of Stardust. There are a couple of photon cannons that they do count as anti-air, but there's not enough of them. They're going to be killed off as well. And Stardust, he has actually shut down a lot of this, but all he needs is a single drone to run to the other side of the map, build a, you know, just create an extractor or something like that. But he actually doesn't have any more money.
Oh,
where are Jadon's buildings?
He's attacking into the Spine Crawlers here. A bad, bad decision because there's simply only two Immortals. And Jadon's going to return, I think. Maybe not. Hold on a minute. He's going to kill this Nexus first, then go. So if he kills this Nexus, there is no way at all to rebuild it. There's no way at all to actually, you know, mine money to make anti-air. There's only those Sentries. No, he's already lost a couple. Jadon needs to return. He cannot lose this base himself. Remember, he only has a couple of structures left. Jadon, Mutalisks. Mutalisks, where are they?
Well, they're now finally making their way over, but the Zealots and Immortals might be able to pick off these remaining buildings. Of course, the Broodlings that come out from the destroyed Zerg villains to try to stop this. What does Jadon have left?
Oh.
Just these two extractors! Stardust could win this game!
Stardust down the south! Probes are gonna kill the last extractor!
Oh my god! He's gonna get the extractor! He's gonna win this game! The base race, make a favor of our Protoss player! He's got the surround! Oh my god! Stardust wins the game!
Oh my god! God, Jadon, Stardust. Don't you worry, don't you worry, child. She has got a plan for you. Don't you worry, don't you worry, child. All right. In StarCraft II, there is two ways to win this game. You force your opponent out where he says GG, or you kill all his structures. Jadon set up a beautiful situation to win the game. We talked about all the small things he was doing. Killing the Cybernetics Core, stopping his opponent's income, just destroying all of the anti-air. Then all of a sudden, he realized, I don't have many structures left. Stardust, with his workers, killed the last structure of Jadon. Meaning, Stardust takes that map and is now currently leading this best of five series, two wins to one loss, and is now in a match point, game point situation. Incredible.
Guys, I just want to stress to you how close that game was. If Jadon had gotten a drone with enough minerals to build that extractor at almost any other corner of this map, those Mutalisks would have had the time to pick off the remaining army units. Those probes that he sent to the bottom right position, you know, he made that click over there. If he'd gone anywhere else, that's it. Sardas, he doesn't win the game. He would kill off those extractors, and he'd say, okay, well, I don't know where your last building is. And it absolutely... I don't have words to describe just how close that match was.